So Ray McGovern. As a member of the CIA, Mr. McGovern briefed President Reagan from 1981 through 1985 on matters of national security. McGovern was a founding member of the Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, who warned of faulty intelligence in the run-up to the invasion of Iraq in 2003 and more recently questioned U.S. intelligence in Ukraine. Mr. McGovern holds a master's degree in Russian studies from Fordham University, a certificate in theological studies from Georgetown, and is a graduate of Harvard Business School's Advanced Management Program. We are so honored to have him speak to us tonight, and so please welcome Ray McGovern.
Well, thanks for coming out. Wow. You know, I haven't thought much about unions like this that I so much admire since Occupy, when I marched with many of your affiliates. And actually, I tell people that when I was very young, like a baby in the Bronx, at baptism, they also conferred membership in the union and membership in the Democratic Party. Now, I've since given up my membership in the Democratic Party because I don't think it's working. I don't think the Republican Party is working either. But, you know, just seeing the poster out there of one of my heroes, Cesar Chavez, you know, I'm reminded of the guts that he had. And I'm reminded of all the people who used to say, Cesar, we have to wait until we have more people. There aren't enough of us. And he would say, look, you keep writing nice articles, you keep making speeches, but without action, nothing's gonna happen. And you know what? There are enough of us. And he was right. Si se puede. And I think that as we mull these issues over together tonight, I would really like it if we would always keep in mind that we can change things and that there are certain things we can do right in our own milieu here, whatever it is, whether it's about the sheriff, whether it's about whatever, and that there are things we can do to honor the tradition of Cesar Chavez. Another one of my heroes is Archbishop Romero. And, you know, he said the same thing, basically. I was calling up one of my favorite quotes from him, or one of my favorite quotes, two of them, actually. And what he said was this, a church, he was talking about his church, a church that doesn't provoke any crises, you know, a gospel that doesn't unsettle, a word of God that doesn't get under anyone's skin, what gospel is that? Those preachers who avoid every thorny matter so as not to be harassed. And you know who they are. So they want to avoid conflicts and difficulties. They do not light up the world that we live in. More poignantly, I remember Romero saying, the chief task of all of us, progressives, action-oriented people, is at present, no callar por miedo. Not to be silent out of fear. And so, I'm roaming around the country trying to do my part, and people think since I worked at the Central Intelligence Agency for 27 years, I might know something. And I'm willing to trade on that, you know? Whether it's true or not. Now, I watched a lot of stuff, and I've filtered down some of this stuff into what I find appeals to college people and university people. It's the old adage, a picture is worth a thousand words. And what I want to do, can you see this in the back? You can, good, okay. What I want to do is kind of set the stage here and go back to right after World War II. Some of you look like you might be almost as old as I am. I was born a week before Hitler drove his tanks into Poland. So I lived through that war as a very young person, but then when I grew up, the war was the whole thing, okay, the whole nine yards. And after the war, we had a State Department that decided, you know, this is really new for us. We're not involved very much abroad, and so we had to figure out how we're going to conduct ourselves. So the Policy Planning Council of the State Department in 1948, so 3 years after the war, they decided, oh, hey, look at this. Everybody else is decimated. Europe is destroyed. Russia has lost 25 million people. That's something most people forget, you know? 20 million civilians, 5 million soldiers. That's a lot, you know? Okay, so we end up with 50% of the world's wealth, but we only have 6.3% of its population. So what do we have to do? We have to do everything we can to maintain this disparity, okay? Well, there it is, folks. That's the document. Now, to do that, we're going to have to dispense with sentimentality and daydreaming. We can't deceive ourselves that we can afford the luxury of altruism. We can't keep talking about human rights and vague, unreal objectives like raising living standards and democratization. The day is not far off when we will have to deal in straight power concepts. So, that set the stage, folks. It wasn't when the Soviet Union imploded that we became the sole remaining superpower in the world. We were it right after World War II, and we decided that's what we had to do. Now, what does it mean to control 50% of the world's wealth? What are we talking about? Anyone, just shout it out.
Oil.
Here you go, oil, what else? Natural gas, natural resources. So what I'd like to do is fast forward now and show you a clip that probably none of you have seen. And it's the result of our avarice, our greed, our thinking that we need to have more than our share of resources. And just to lead into this, I have to tell you that we have 9 grandchildren, and I learned most of my lessons from the grandchildren. And little Ronan was 4 years old one time, and he was in nursery school down there in Oakland. Then I was proctoring an exam right there in their nursery school. A kid, of course. I was helping out. So I went up to the teacher afterwards. I said, these are really cute for you. I mean, they're just, but what do you think you can teach four-year-olds at this stage? And she said, oh, Mr. McGovern, that's very, very simple. Come sit down. I sat down around the table. She said, how many toys do you see on that table? I said, 7. She says, well, how many chairs around the table? 10. That's it, Mr. McGovern. I said, I don't understand. She says, we have to teach them how to share. As soon as they're old enough to share, we have to teach them that. Now, George Kennan, who drafted that statement I showed there, or George Bush, or Dick Cheney, they never went to that nursery school. Okay. Now, why do we go into Iraq? Well, the first lesson is that it wasn't because we thought they had weapons of mass destruction. We knew they didn't. So when Bush and Cheney keep saying, oh, what a terrible mistake, our major regret is the mistaken intelligence before Iraq, they continue to lie. If you take nothing else from tonight, take this. It wasn't a mistake, it was fraud. And the most deep disappointment of my professional life is that some of my former colleagues, I retired in 1990, some of my former colleagues participated in that fraud because they wanted to get ahead, because they were careerists. And if you don't want to take my word for the fraud, well, after a 5-year Senate investigation by the Senate Intelligence Committee, the committee chair at that time, Jay Rockefeller, issued a bipartisan report onto which Chuck Hagel and one of those senators up in Maine, the 2 Republicans, signed on. And Jay Rockefeller said, the evidence produced to justify, in quotes, the war in Iraq was, quote, unsubstantiated, comma, contradicted, comma, or even non-existent, period, end quote. So let me just ask you to imagine what non-existent intelligence is like. Okay. They wanted to go to war in Iraq, partly for the reasons that I had used in that first string, you know, natural resources, oil, somebody shouted out, and also for Israel. They thought that by deposing Saddam Hussein, they would make that part of the world safer for Israel. Now, it may have for maybe a couple of years, but look at the bedlam in Iraq now. Not safer for anybody. The last, of course, was the permanent military base. Oops, Larry. I have to remember the euphemisms they use. It's not permanent military bases. It's enduring military
bases. All those enduring young military bases, give me a break.
You know, what's going on here? Is enduring, does that sound more like endearing? Is it endearing military? Give me a break. But that's the euphemisms that they use. Now, what I'm going to show you here is what happens when the U.S. or anyone else embarks on a war of aggression. Now, Nuremberg, after World War II, had a very precise definition for a war of aggression. They hanged a lot of the people who were responsible for it, including a lawyer, which somehow gives me some sort of satisfaction. I mean, I was just at Berkeley Law School, and there's a fellow named John Yoo there that thinks the Constitution is quaint, obsolete. So after Nuremberg, they said a war of aggression is the supreme international crime, differing from other war crimes only insofar as it contains the accumulated evil of the whole. Wow. The accumulated evil of the whole. What do you suppose they're thinking about? What would you include as a result? Yes, please.
Torture, murder, kidnapping, rape.
Yeah, okay. Just as an example, torture, kidnapping, black holes, prisons, rape. And then, watch my language here, fooling around with our civil rights, fooling around with the first 10 commandments that the people who pledge their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor to our founders, who were just as actually much more liable to end up in the end of a rope than as leaders of our country. You know, we need to take that stuff seriously. And we've been talking tonight about the Fourth Amendment and how that's been involved, that's been violated by the National Security Agency and those who told it to do that. This here is a small rendition of a German documentary. When Bradley Manning was first wrapped up and put into Quantico, sort of the same difference actually. Freudian slip, huh? You know, I don't know, are there any Marines here? Yeah, okay. Well, we Army guys, you know, used to, joust with the Marines. I just don't know how the Marines agreed that when the Army said, would you take Bradley Manning, he's sort of a private in our Army, but we want him tortured, we want to give him the business. And the Marines said, okay, we'll do that. In Quantico, he was given the business, okay? Now, why? You're going to see why. I'm going to show you a little film clip that came out of a program called Panorama. German television was interested in what's happening with Bradley Manning and why and all this kind of stuff. A really good documentary program named Panorama ran a 60 minutes type segment on this. Okay. And when I saw it, I spent 5 years in Germany, so I knew how it came out. And I said, look, you got to undub that. I said, was denn? Undub? I said, yeah, you got to turn it back into English because we need it here in this country. Oh, we never do that. We don't do that. We don't do that. I said, well, I pretty much had a promise to give them 3 of my 5 children. But I didn't have to. In the end, they relented. And what you see here is the result of that. It's about 10 minutes or so. And I just ask you to kind of look at it, appreciate it in the context of what I showed first on that first slide. And then we're going to, if it's okay with you all, we're going to spend a whole minute in silence before we start discussing it again. Can you do that, Rick?
A neighborhood in Baghdad, July 2007. Shots are fired from the air, fired from an American Apache helicopter. Minutes later, U.S. infantry soldier Ethan McCord arrives at the scene.
when I came up onto that scene, I remember thinking, you know, oh, well, this guy with the RPG or this guy with the AK-47 obviously did this to the van. There's no way in hell that we would do this.
This military video shocked the world when WikiLeaks released it almost a year ago. And this man is being blamed for illegally downloading it from a secured army network. 23-year-old Bradley Manning, who has been held in solitary confinement for 7 months. A small group of supporters is demanding his release, but their voices are drowned out by media that has largely presumed his guilt.
I'm sorry, that's treason. So, there's no gray area about it. And so that is a capital offense.
You capital can't offense, have so you're saying execution. Army. You're saying execution.
If he is convicted of treason, I absolutely would support a capital punishment.
Oh, shut down WikiLeaks. But got a presidential order to shut that down. This guy should be tried, Manning should be tried for treason, executed if he's found guilty.
Whoever in our government leaked that information is guilty of treason. And I think anything less than execution is too kind a penalty.
The onboard camera of this attack helicopter is targeting a group of people in a neighborhood in Baghdad. Among them are two journalists from the news agency Reuters. The photographer Nami Nur Eldin and his assistant Said Hamiga. The men can neither see nor hear the helicopter that is stalking them. It is too far away. The pilots mistake Nur Eldin's camera for a weapon. And attack them.
Let me know when you need them. Light
them all up.
Come on, fire!
Hey, Roger.
Scenes that resemble a video game, but what you see here is real. Real people. The pilots are laughing and making macabre jokes.
God damn it, guys.
The Apache gunner is still targeting the heavily wounded Reuters employee Saad Hamiga. He will not survive. Later, the Pentagon investigates the incident and concludes that chopper pilots had done nothing wrong. The attack was part of a combat operation. It was justified because earlier American soldiers had come under fire by insurgents. The Pentagon has denied a request for an interview. However, one individual has been punished, Bradley Manning, in jail accused of leaking the video. The charges, downloading and disseminating classified information. His roots lie in Europe. As a teenager, he moved to Great Britain, to the small town Haverford West. His mother is British, his father American. Here, he attended school for 4 years and graduated with Tom Dyer. He was one of Manning's closest friends. To Dyer, it is no surprise that Manning might have released the video. He remembers his friend as a great idealist, even when he was still a teenager.
He had a great moral compass. He knew in himself what was wrong and what was right, and he didn't like the thought of people abusing their status and making other people feel small and doing things that were wrong.
It was precisely for this reason that Manning joined the army. He said he wanted to fight for the good, but during the Iraq War, he apparently started to have doubts. As an intelligence analyst, he had access to secret military files, including the video with the disturbing scenes. The video shows how Reuters employee Saad Hamiga is struggling for his life. He survived the first shots fired from the attack helicopter. The pilots are still keeping track of him. Meanwhile, Salim Atasha Tumal and his two small children, Sayad and Duaha, are on their way to school. From his van, he sees the wounded Reuters employee lying on the curb. Tumal stops the car, gets out to help him. His two little children remain in the front of the van. The pilots request permission to shoot, again and again. The father is unaware of all of this. He does not even notice the helicopter above him. Tumal wants to rush the wounded Reuters employee to a hospital, His compassion will seal his fate.
1-8, clear. 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 Clear.
Even when the soldiers realize that they have shot children, they only hesitate for a moment, then make cynical remarks from the air. Since that day, U.S. Army soldier Ethan McCourt has been heavily traumatized. He still cannot get the images out of his head. As an Army infantryman, he was one of the first soldiers on the scene. When he arrives at the van, he hears the 5-year-old girl scream.
So I grabbed the girl and I took her into the house behind the van with a medic, and we were cleaning her up. And what I did is I took my gloves off and was pulling glass out of her eyes so that she can blink without cutting her eyes.
Then McCourt runs back to the van to check on the boy. The child is still alive but badly injured. He carries the boy back to the medics as well. As his superiors observe this, they vehemently order him to stop saving the children. Instead, he should do his job and secure the area they command.
Another thing that bothered me was the fact that I was the only one to care enough, it seemed, for the children to try to ensure that they get medical attention.
Former Army officer Ray McGovern is shocked by the actions of the pilots. He had been a CIA analyst for 27 years and an advisor to 7 presidents, including George Bush Sr.
How could anyone justify shooting up that man, shooting up the person who was crawling onto the curb? These are war crimes, pure and simple. When I learned to be a soldier and officer in the U.S. Army, I learned that you don't shoot at civilians, you certainly don't shoot people trying to rescue the wounded, and you don't blow up vans with a couple of children in them.
In the Pentagon investigation report, there's no mention of war crimes. The pilots had reacted adequately.
Here's the government saying that we did no wrong. But yet they lied. They covered up the story. They covered up everything.
Sometimes it takes a little while to buffer the thing, and you've seen pretty much, I guess, enough, haven't we? So let's take that full minute just to be quiet with ourselves, inside ourselves, and then we can talk about it. Those of you who have your eyes closed, you can rejoin us now. I have to take that minute. So this is gun barrel photography, right? Nobody has accused anyone of forging this or saying it's inauthentic. Lots of people being brutalized in this film. Who are some of the people who are being brutalized? Anyone? The journalists, right? The 2 Reuters people who have been killed. Who else?
In a sense, the pilots too.
Exactly. Yeah. Our own men have been brutalized. You can hear it in their conversation. You know. Now, What I really detest is people say, well, they signed up for this, you know, they're volunteers, they're volunteer army. And you guys know, probably better than most folks, what volunteer army means. It's not the same army I served in during Vietnam. Everyone was liable. Everyone was vulnerable to being drafted or serving as an officer as I did. This time, nobody important. The army is composed primarily more than 50% of people who live in small towns of America, less than 50,000 people, and the inner city. It's a poverty draft. It's not worthy of America. So, those are the people who are being brutalized here, and not only they, but people like Ethan McCord, who does know right from wrong, and has gone through a real tough number of years with PTSD. What else might be said here? Well, you should know that there was a Washington Post reporter with this unit. He saw this video that evening, and some of you are old enough to remember old Uncle Remus songs, you know, old Burr Fox, what'd he do? He didn't say nothing. As a matter of fact, this Washington Post reporter wrote a glowing book as a big tribute to this unit. So, the other thing you should know is that Bradley Manning, in releasing this information, he tried to go to the Washington, well, he did go to the New York Times, and they said, we're going to have a committee meet on this and, you know, share this information. God, you know, he said, no, I don't need any committee. Washington Post never returned his call. So it's not quite fair to say that he went to WikiLeaks, but to his credit, he wouldn't let it go. He had also seen young people his age, 22, okay, on the streets of Baghdad, wrapped up for no other reason than they had written a critical term paper criticizing Maliki, their prime minister, and wrapped up and put in Baghdad jails where Bradley Manning and everyone else knew what went on there. You know, torture, real torture. So I went to his commander and he says, you know what's happening? You know, when we wrap up these people, the Iraqis take them and they talk. Shut up, go home, stay in your, you know, stay out of this, go home and keep your mouth shut. So Bradley Manning, like Edward Snowden, like Dan Ellsberg, they had a conscience that wouldn't let them to callar, you know. No callar por miedo. They wouldn't keep silent out of fear. And so that's why we have this footage. And it's important to know that part of this lesson is that, well, let me put it this way. I try to make it a point in every talk that I give to tell you that after 51 years in Washington, I've seen a lot of change, right? But there's one change that dwarfs all the other changes in importance. And that change is that we no longer have a free media. We no longer have, in any real sense, a free media, and that is big. That could not be bigger. I mean, Thomas Jefferson was asked, you know, if you had a choice between a government and a free media, which would you pick? Free media every time. Because without the media, or with press in those days, of course, you can't keep the government honest. So, that being the case, I just want to give you an example of how people are treated on the, what I call the fawning corporate media, if they are regarded as marginal or sort of beyond the pale. Julian Assange, who released Bradley Manning's video, all his reporting, into the ether and made it possible for us to know about it, he was harshly criticized by the same folks that you saw criticizing Bradley Manning, saying that, you know, he should be prosecuted, persecuted, he should be given the death penalty, and so forth. So, this was so prevalent. I mean, Fox News, ABC, and MSNBC, the whole round of them say, Julian Assange is a terrorist. He's a terrorist. He's not a journalist, he's a terrorist. And then somebody apparently told, who was it, CNN, you know, it's getting a little obvious here. 99% of your commentators are saying he's a terrorist. You ought to have somebody on to give the other side. And so they picked me. So it's one of the few times I've ever been on CNN, but I want to show you what happens when somebody tries to speak up and talk to the other side of the thing. Now, it would be number three.
Clear, many leaders in American government think the founder of WikiLeaks is a criminal. I hope the Justice Department will soon indict him and that we will be able to extradite him from Britain and bring him back to stand trial in the United States.
I think that the release of this information has put at risk American national security.
One politician even called Assange a high-tech terrorist. So how can one person's terrorist also be called the ultimate journalist? For perspective on that, we go to Ray McGovern, who is live in Washington for us. McGovern is part of a group of former CIA members who recently wrote a letter praising Assange's actions. So thank you for joining us tonight. Why do you think Assange is doing the right thing by releasing all these documents?
Well, I think the question as to whether he's a journalist or not is the proof is in the pudding. The function of a journalist is to record the actions and behavior of those in power and make it possible for the public to know what's going on. Thomas Jefferson said that if it were a choice between a government and a free press, he'd pick a free press. And so this is what's needed to preserve a democracy, and the idea is to tell as close to the truth as possible and not simply take notes on what the government is saying. That's what Julian Assange and WikiLeaks have done. To the embarrassment of the government, because a lot of their dealings are kept in secret and need not be kept in secret.
So you don't like the label, you don't like the way he's been labeled a terrorist or a hacker. You actually do think that he is a journalist. I want to get that correct. Do you think he's a journalist?
Of course he's a journalist, according to the definition that I just listed here. He's making information available to the American people and others who are frankly malnourished on what I call the fawning corporate media, who act more as stenographers than they do as journalists.
So you don't think there's information in those documents that should have been left out or maybe blacked out that may be detrimental to the country, maybe detrimental to our troops or even other countries? Because that's what journalists would have fact-checked, and there are standards, and no one wants to put people in danger and in jeopardy. I think that's what most journalists would have done. Julian Assange didn't do that.
Well, I correct you on that. He did do that. He made that information available to the Pentagon and the State Department, and they refused to expunge it. They refused to redact it. Now, what has been released? It is a canard. It is a red herring to suggest that lives have been put in danger. The only lives that are put in danger are the troops that we sent over to Iraq and Afghanistan under false pretenses. Now, the Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, has said that these reports about lives in danger are greatly overwrought, his word, okay? He said that no sources and methods have been compromised. NATO has said the same thing, and our command in Afghanistan has said the same thing. Not one person has been identified as having been spat upon, much less imprisoned, because of these documents. Now, that doesn't mean that the pundits here in this country don't say it 10 times a day. Saying it 10 times a day does not make it true.
His attorney said the same thing on the steps of the courthouse, that this was a setup, talking about the charges in Sweden. This was just one way to get him into custody, to keep him there, and that this is what journalists should be doing. So you really think we, and I'll say we, I'm a journalist, you think we have it wrong, and that he is actually not a pariah. We should be praising him and following his lead rather than calling him a pariah?
Yeah, actually, with all due respect, I think you should be following his example. Seek out the secrets. Find out why it is that my taxpayer money is going to fund trafficked young boys performing dances in women's clothing before the Afghan security forces who we are recruiting to take over after we leave. Take a look at the documents and see the abhorrent activities that our government has endorsed or done through its contractors. And then tell me you don't think the Americans can handle that. Well, I think they can handle it, but they can't handle it if they don't have it.
All right, Ray McGovern, thank you. Appreciate your time. It's going to have to be the last word. A closer look at the cyber attacks.
Guess how long it took for me to be on CNN again.
You're still waiting, right?
Yeah. Sometimes I get on CNN International, but very seldom on CNN Domestic. But I just show that to show you, you know, they're really out to press, even when they get the fair and balanced guy, the 1% guy. I hate to be called a 1% guy, but anyhow, you know, the exception to the rule. Now, that's key, folks, because that's key, folks.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Because that really is important. Americans just don't know what the hell's going on. Unless, and what's the good news? The fourth estate is dead. That's bad news, but what's the good news? Right, there's a fifth estate. And where is that fifth estate?
Citizens, journalists.
It's somewhere in the ether somewhere, you know? And all I know is it comes down to my computer, you know, whenever I turn the computer on. And if I know where to look, I can not only know what's going on quicker, but I can know it much more instantaneously than I did when I worked for the CIA as an analyst, you know? I come down in my pajamas and I watch Amy Goodman. I don't know if you know democracynow.org, but that sets me up for the day, okay? Now, what I, you know, I'm Irish, okay? And so I get up at 17 minutes before 8. It runs live at 8 o'clock in Washington because it takes 15 minutes for an Irishman to brew a decent cup of coffee. Now, I'm talking instant coffee. And then after two more minutes, I'm sort of wide awake. And I learned from that first 15 minutes or so of street news, stuff you'll never get in the newspaper. If it comes in the Washington Post 3 weeks later, it'll be on page A17. So that sets me up. And by the time 11 o'clock comes around, I've read all my email. People think about me, you know, they say, well, just in case you missed this, Ray, you ought to see it. And by 11 o'clock, I'm at the same point where I used to be at 4:30 pudding time at CIA headquarters. I'm ready to write, I'm ready to, you know, to interview, I'm ready to do whatever is requested of me that day. So the internet is the saving grace here. Now, I'm gonna fast forward here to the surveillance issue because I think that's really, really important. I think it has local reverberations. It's just, it's incredible what's happened. Let me just set the stage here. Whoops. When George Bush was running for re-election in 2004, James Risen, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for the New York Times, discovered that Dick Cheney and George Bush had told the head of NSA, "Hey, General Hayden, we know about that sacred first commandment out there at NSA, thou shalt not eavesdrop on Americans without a court warrant. We know all about that. Forget about it. Now, they started that before 9/11. Folsom Street down there in San Francisco, they had backdoored into AT&T, Verizon, so they were collecting stuff on us before. But after 9/11, finish the sentence for me, guys. After 9/11, everything
changed.
Right. So, after 9/11, this went on steroids, okay? James Risen found out about it in the summer. It was July or August of 2004. I said, wow, he gets great scoops, okay? He has incredible contacts in the intelligence agencies. So he told his bosses at the New York Times, hey, guess what? Cheney and Bush are violating the Fourth Amendment willy-nilly. The FISA law, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, willy-nilly, and you know, they've suborned the head of the NSA into doing this, okay? Now what does the Fourth Amendment say? Fourth Amendment says, right, yeah. No one, let's see, how does it say? It's about security. Yeah, the right of people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue except upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and specifically defining the places to be searched and the people or things to be seized, period, end quote. Now, did our founders feel strongly about that? And you know why, right? Okay. So, General Hayden, who was head of the NSA, when Cheney said do this, instead of observing his solemn oath, which we all took, many of us have taken, you know, to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, he said, I will jump as high as you wish me to jump. I will get all manner of collecting all the information on Americans, and we'll just go ahead because you told me to. So, what happened was, James Risen went to his betters at the New York Times and they said, oh gosh, James, this is this election coming up and we better check it out with, who are they gonna check it out with? They got this information that Cheney and Bush, who are they gonna check it out with? The White House. The White House, yeah! Now, it's hard to believe, but the New York Times used to be an independent newspaper. Forget about it. Forget about it. They went to the White House and said, oh, we have this information, and you know, we know it's just before the election, 5 months before the election, and so should we? No, you can't. Terror, terrorists. 9/11, fear, terrorists. You can't publish this because we're getting all manner of lucrative information on terrorists. We're preventing terrorist acts on this. Bald-faced lie. We know that's a bald-faced lie, okay? So Sulzberger said, okay. Fast forward a year and a half to December of 2005. James Risen goes to his superiors and says, this is a little bit embarrassing because I wrote a book. And two chapters have to do with this story. And the book's in galley, it's gonna come out in 2 weeks, and it's gonna be looking very odd if the national security correspondent for the New York Times written a book and the New York Times hasn't published a story. Good. So Sulzberger said, oh gosh. So what did Sulzberger do? Quick, what did he do? Yeah, no. What did he do? Call the White House, call the White House.
Oh, okay.
And White House called him into the Oval Office and said, you can't do this. National security, terror, 9/11, terrorist, national security. And Sulzberger, I suppose to his credit, to him, we're supposed to be all the news is fit to print, and it's just, you know, we're the flagship, we can't, we're gonna publish it. And then he left him to George, well, I don't agree. Well, 10 days later, it appeared on the front page of the New York Times, right before Christmas 2005. Now, General Hayden, who had done all this stuff, had been promoted to be Deputy National Intelligence Director, okay, just under the chief that oversees all 16 intelligence agencies. So he was enlisted to explain it all to the rest of us, right? He's gonna explain it, why it was necessary and all that stuff. And so he appeared before the National Press Club in the later part of January 2006 now, okay? And if you can play that clip, this is just a minute and a half, I think, so if you fall asleep, you can miss the whole thing, and it's on the exam, so we'll take a note.
My understanding is that the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution specifies that you must have probable cause to be able to do a search that does not violate an American's right against unlawful seizures and searches and seizures.
Actually, the Fourth Amendment actually protects all of us against unreasonable search and seizure.
But
that's what it says.
The measure is probable cause, actually.
The amendment says unreasonable search and seizure.
But does it not say probable?
No.
The legal standard is probable cause.
Just to be very clear, okay? And believe me, if there's any amendment to the Constitution that employees of the National Security Agency are familiar with, it's the Fourth.
Right.
And it is a reasonable standard in the Fourth Amendment.
To quote the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution of the United States in its entirety, the one the general and the NSA folks are so familiar with and know is about reasonableness and not about probable cause, quote, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, no warrant shall issue, but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. Well, maybe they have a different constitution over there at the NSA.
Okay, little teaching point here. Where did I say that the press conference was?
National press club.
Right. Okay. So there were some. Anybody known about that? Was it reported the next day by any of those journalists over there? I mean, hello. This happens all the time. Now, that's what we're up against. General Hayden, of course, was immediately sacked, right?
Yeah, right.
You guys are good. Okay. Was he sacked?
No.
What? Yeah, he was promoted. Right. He did such a good service with explaining all this stuff to all of us that they picked him to head up the CIA. I had a little front row seat for a vignette that I think speaks volumes. I had a big debate. A little debate with Secretary of Defense, Rumsfeld, in Atlanta on the 4th of May 2006. It was an impromptu thing. I wasn't out of order. It was a Q&A, and we engaged in this debate. Well, I got on, nothing else happened in the whole world that day, and this happened about noon, and so I got on almost all the TV stations. Some of you may have seen it. Well, as a result, Lou Dobbs, up there, Lou Dobbs up there in New York says, McGovern, I'd like to come up and appear on my show. So, I went to talk to you about this Rumsfeld thing. So I went up to him. Lou Dobbs, a lot of people watch Lou Dobbs. You know, I never turned down an invitation to be able to get some air or a FaceTime. So I'm up there and I'm sitting in the blue room there, and something really curious happened. The most respected senior intelligence official of our government ever is called Admiral Bobby Ray Inman, who was head of NSA back in the 70s when they proposed the FISA law prohibiting the kinds of things that Hayden was suborned into doing. He wrote part of the law. He was deputy director of the CIA and he quit because Bill Casey was doing all kinds of illegal things, okay? So here's a guy, he's down in Texas, he's hugely respected in Congress and elsewhere, and he comes running into the green room, disheveled, no tie. I've never seen him like this before. And somebody quickly puts a tie on him and sends him in to see Lou Dobbs on my time. Now, how do you explain that? Well, 10 days before, he had appeared in the New York Public Library with James Risen, the author of, you know, the fellow, and a few other people. It was not really private, but there were only a few people there. But somebody blogged it, and I saw it. And when they asked Bobby Ray Inman, Admiral Inman, what do you think about General Hayden, he said, well, he clearly violated the law. I know, because I helped draft the law. Matter of fact, I put in a paragraph that says, you cannot do anything other than what is expressly permitted in this law. So clearly, if I had to do it, the law is okay. Now, who learned about that? Anybody who read this fellow's blog, it was the Washington blog, it was a good blog, and not many people knew about it. But Amy Goodman knew about it. So what'd she do? That morning, when I'm sitting in Lou Dobbs' office, that morning on her show, she shows a video of Admiral Bobby Ray Inman saying, this guy violated the law, this guy violated the law. And Hayden is just about to go before the Senate for confirmation, okay? So in walks Bobby Ray Inman. I say, Admiral Inman, way to go in the New York Library. He puts his tie on, he goes in there, and I'm watching the Bluetooth, and Lou Dobbs says, well, Admiral Inman, what do you think of General Hayden being nominated for head of the CIA? And he says, you couldn't pick a better person. He's full of integrity. He's technically qualified. I give him my unqualified endorsement. I'm looking at this thing, you know. And this is the best of the guys, you know. And I'm saying, holy, I'm saying all kinds of profanity to myself. And then he comes out and said, what the hell happened to it? You ran out. You took the tie with them. They borrowed a tie, you know? And I wanted to follow him, but, you know, I had my four minutes of glory there with Lou Dobbs, so I wasn't going to go. But there it is, folks. It's a fraternity. The best of them cover one another. Now I'm going to show you one other clip, and then we can kind of talk this thing through as to what it means for us. When it became clear to some of us that the NSA was doing precisely what Hayden had been subordinate to doing, and when it became clear that they were collecting everything, and I mean everything, it was hard. It was mind-boggling that they could collect all our telephone calls, that they could collect all our email and stuff. Mind-boggling. And so the cover story was, well, it's not. It's just the metadata. It's just the to and from, and it's just the subject. Well, you don't need warehouses several football fields big in Utah to store metadata. You know how much you could put on a thumb drive. This is content, folks, and I can prove it to you. Content. So they're storing all that stuff, and, you know, before I forget to say it, not one terrorist attack has been prevented from building this big haystack of material. Now, do they have sophisticated retrieval devices? Yes, they do. Okay. But just as with fingerprints, which J. Edgar Hoover was, you know, pretty good at, or at least he didn't invent them, but he was there when they were invented. You can find who the bank robber is if the bank robber puts his finger on the teller window, right? But how many bank robberies have been prevented by fingerprints? It's the same thing.
Yeah.
How many terrorist events have been prevented by zero? The president's own committee said that. The committee set up by the 9/11 commission said that. Everybody says, not one. Okay, now what did General Alexander, the successor to General Hayden, say? 54. In the next hearing, he said, one. And Clapper, his boss, said, maybe two. You know what that one was? It was a Somali taxi driver in San Diego who sent $6,000 to his friend in Mogadishu, Somalia, and his friend happened to belong to a known terrorist group. Did it prevent an incident? Well, General Alexander says it did, but he already said there were 54, and now it's down to one. I don't think has much credibility. So in the midst of all this, Ron Wyden, senator from just north of here, Oregon, and to his credit, a constitutional lawyer, he had heard these rumors about NSA collecting all this information. And so if we could have the next clip, we'll see Ron Wyden asking James Clapper, who is now the head of national intelligence, sitting above all the 16 intelligence agencies, a very pregnant question. And this is only, again, another minute and a half, so stay awake, please.
Just one, Madam Chair, and I thank you, and this is for you, Director Clapper, again on the surveillance front, and I hope we can do this in just a yes or no answer, because I know Senator Feinstein wants to move on. Last summer, the NSA director was at a conference, and he was asked a question about the NSA surveillance of Americans. He replied, and I quote here, "The story that we have millions or hundreds of millions of dossiers on people is completely false." The reason I'm asking the question is, having served on the committee now for a dozen years, I don't really know what a dossier is in this context. So what I wanted to see is if you could give me a yes or no answer to the question, does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir.
It does not.
Not wittingly. inadvertently, perhaps, collect, but not wittingly.
Thank you. I'll have additional questions to give you in writing on that point, but I thank you for the answer.
Thank you very much.
Guess what, folks? Ron Wyden gave him that question the day before. Told him that he was going to ask that question. He was under oath. Now, there are probably some lawyers around here. I don't understand the law real well, but it's a felony to lie to Congress. It's also a felony to lie under oath. You know, that's a double whammy for me. Now, who is watching that? Young fella. I'll give you a hint. First name is Ed.
Yeah, right. Ed Snowden. You guys are good.
Okay. Now, how do we know that? Because Ed Snowden told that NBC interviewer in Moscow 2 months ago that when he saw that, he saw the head of national intelligence lying to the American people when he knew that they were scooping up just everything and violating the Fourth Amendment left and right. They said, that's it. That's it. And he collected what he collected, and he realized he had to get out of Dodge. Why? Look what happened to Bradley Manning. Look what happened to Tom Drake, who was an NSA executive. 4 years of persecution, okay? So, that was a biggie, okay, this big lie. Now, let me just finish this so that we can get to questions. But, you know, people keep saying, well, wait a second. I'm purer than Caesar's wife. You know, I don't have anything to hide. They get all my telephone calls and all my emails. You know, the big thing, folks, is you don't get to decide how they interpret these things. And I mentioned Tom Drake just now. They raided his home, took out everything from his office, and one piece of paper that was not classified, they took a big secret stamp and went, secret. And they tried to get him convicted under the Espionage Act, or maybe 20 years in prison. At the end of that trial, the judge in Maryland, federal judge, looked down at these 9 Justice Department lawyers and said, don't you ever dare bring a case like this to me in my court again, based on such flimsy evidence, some of it contrived, some of it even fabricated. Get out of here, all 10 felony charges dismissed. Now, that was the good news. The bad news was, Tom Drake's bankrupt. He was making $160,000 because of his technical expertise and his leadership qualities. He's now working in a Macintosh store, into which, at one point, Eric Holder marched, the Attorney General. And Tom looked at him and he said, you better get out of here.
And his bodyguards
spurred him right out of there. Tom Drake was not going to wait on Eric Holder, you know. He might have thrown a Mac at him or something. Anyhow, that's how bad it was. Now, so you don't get to decide, and I just have to tell you that after Ed Snowden revealed what he did, people tried to seek out an expert in this field. Now, how many of you have seen Das Leben der Anderen, The Lives of Others? Okay, it's on the web now. It's an incredible film. It's about the East German Stasi, okay? The secret police. One out of every 9, I think, East Germans worked for the secret police. And this shows how they're monitoring everything, including suspected dissident artists and stuff like that. Anyhow, they asked Wolfgang Schmidt, who was an old Stasi senior operative, and that's his real name, Wolfgang Schmidt. They said, Wolfgang, what do you say to people who say, I have nothing to hide? And Wolfgang says, these people, they are incredibly naive to think that they have nothing to hide. This is why the governments collect this secret information to use against them. The only way to prevent it from using it against them is to prevent it from being collected in the first place. And that's it, folks. That's it. Now, Congress is fiddling around with some legislation, but none of it goes far enough to prevent it from being collected in the first place. And it's just really, you could get angry about it, actually. How do they use this information now, even? How many of you know about parallel construction? It's not like building a road alongside another road.
Yeah, you do.
Pardon?
Are you talking about language?
No, I'm talking about taking illegally acquired information through these wiretaps and calling the sheriff here in, where are we? Sacramento. And saying, hey, sheriff, you go down to 4th Street and Pickering, and there's a, you're going to find, you can get a nice drug bust at 8 o'clock tonight. Where do they get that? Illegally acquired eavesdropping. Do they tell the sheriff where they get it? Probably not. They say, just a really good source we have, just do it, okay? Then they reconstruct it. They say, well, somebody gave us a tip. Or they make up their own story, and they make a parallel construction of how they learned about this thing, and then they prosecute. It's an outrage on our civil rights. It's incredible that so many of the legal profession cooperate in this kind of thing. The other thing I'll just say is that one of the more recent things we learned was that Unit BD-200 of the Israeli secret police, the ones that do NSA-type work, eavesdropping and so forth, they were in receipt of the take from NSA, including the names of Americans, Palestinians, people like me who are trying to get to Gaza on the U.S. boat to Gaza, the whole schmear. The names have not been excised. They're getting everything, the Israelis, deliberately from NSA. And the reason we know this is because it's ironic that the first time this ever happened, the Israeli spies, the guys, their NSA equivalents, are saying, you know, this is too much. You're using this against the Palestinians in a most deleterious, most unorthodox way. We quit.
Yeah! So, you know, people like Bradley Manning, people like Edward Snowden, people like Julian Assange and Dan Ellsberg, who lives somewhere around here, somewhere in Berkeley, I guess. That's near here somewhere. I think I was there this morning. No, this afternoon. So, it's not a lost cause. And the last thing I'll say is that, well, I like to quote Dr. King. He said a lot of things. I'll quote two things that he said. One is the need for spreading some truth around, the need for exposing things. He had a really interesting metaphor. He said in his wonderful letter from the Birmingham City Jail, which I think is a masterpiece of American literature, he said a lot of things, but one paragraph I've committed to memory. He said, like a boil that can never be cured until it is opened up with all this pus-flowing ugliness to the natural medicines of air and light, so too, injustice and deceit must be disclosed. With all the friction its disclosure creates, the light of human conscience and the air of national opinion before it can be cured. That's our job. The Fourth Estate is dead. We are smart enough to figure out what's going on. We have to bring those neighbors of ours who are in denial and don't want to believe this stuff. Because you know what? Another thing Dr. King said, there is such a thing as too late. Now, I think we're getting pretty close to that. And you know, I'm 75, and I can say, well, but I got 9 grandchildren, 5 children. So, last thing I'll just say is that I studied a lot about what happened in Germany during the war, World War II. And after the war, or you know, just toward the end of the war, the only people who really spoke out against the Nazi regime, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the Lutheran pastor who tried to do it right, confessing church, wrapped up and hanged. There was another guy named Albrecht Haushofer. Anybody ever hear of him? Good. I got to tell you about Albrecht Haushofer. He was a Geolog at the University of Berlin, a geologist, and he had tenure. Now, some of you probably know what tenure is, all right? How did he get tenure? He kept his mouth shut. But he had a conscience, and he watched his Jewish friends and others be wrapped up. And so he started speaking out against the Nazis and actually gathered quite a following. So he was wrapped up and put in a different Berlin jail from the one house, the one that Bonhoeffer was in. Now, the Nazis were very methodical, and they required you to sign a confession before they would shoot you or hang you, which were the two methods of dealing with you. And Haushofer said, nuts to that, I'm not going to confess. And so they shot him anyway because the Allies were coming, all right? And when they picked him up off the floor, out of his pocket, falls a little zettel, a little piece of paper. It was his confession. It was written in the form of a sonnet. It's very brief. I want to read it to you and then translate it, unless there's some German speakers here. Okay. Here it goes.
Schuld.
That's the title. Guilt. Schuld. Doch bin ich schuldig, aber anders als ihr denkt. Yeah, I'm guilty, but it's not what you think. Ich musste früher meine Pflicht erkennen. Früher. I should have earlier recognized my Pflicht, my duty. Ich musste schärfer Unheil. Then I should have more sharply called evil. Mein Urteil habe ich zu lang gelenkt. I put off my judgment far too long. Ich habe gewarnt. I did warn, and he did. Ich habe gewarnt, aber nicht genug. What's genug?
Enough.
Und klar. And clearly. There's no comparative in Germany, in German for klar. Klar, claro, clear, okay? Ich habe gewarnt, aber nicht genug und klar. Und heute weiß ich, was ich schuldig war. And today I recognize what I was guilty of. So, Cesar Chavez says there are enough of us. I believe what he says is absolutely true. All we have to do is get the word around. I have great faith in Americans, once they know what's right and what's wrong, that they'll do the right thing. So let's be faithful to Cesar Chavez and all Archbishop Romero and all people who stood up for justice, you know, all of them. Martin Luther King, Jesus of Nazareth, Yahweh of the Old Testament. That's what they cared about, that we do justice. They didn't care about us sprinkling incense and all that sort of stuff. So let's be faithful to our traditions, whatever traditions they may be. Get out there and do justice. Thank you very much. I'll take your questions.
No, sure. Yeah.